let me try to summarize it in a non-technical way. One of the hypotheses that are currently debated in the scientific community with regard to why the brain shuts off muscle activation during big volume muscular exercise in conditions of high altitude is that the brain doesn't get enough oxygen itself. One of the ways that you can intervene in the amount of oxygen that goes to the brain without changing the amount of oxygen that goes to the legs is by having subjects breathe a particular gas mixture. You can trick the system by giving subjects extra CO2 to breathe. Carbon dioxide, which we produce ourselves normally and have a pretty high level of in our system, tends to be blown off when you're engaging into very intense exercise. It's called hyperventilation. It's not so important, but hyperventilation has as an effect that your cerebral arteries are constricting, so there is less blood going to your brain. So what we did is we devised an experiment where we gave our subjects extra CO2 to breathe in and compared it to the situation where we did not give them extra CO2 while they were pedaling like mad on a bicycle in conditions of 5,000 meters altitude in a simulated fashion. And we were successful in increasing brain blood flow to the brain, but it didn't change the performance. So this model allowed us to test the hypothesis directly and refute it. And now we pass to the next hypothesis.
So my last concern was the reverse model of in the Noakes paper.
Right.
Whether you can explain and comment this to us, how you see this.
Okay.
This, because this is also a certain approach to our test system to look at things.
Here is the basic point around which this discussion is flowing. According to most exercise physiologists, the maximum amount of oxygen that an organism or a human can handle and consume and use for its metabolism is finite. It is limited by physiological capacities. That is to say that it's the end result of a certain amount of breathing, where there is limits to the respiratory system, to a minute volume of blood being pumped by the heart. It's the cardiac output. It's the power of the heart as a pump, which pumps the oxygen-enriched blood to the muscles, and the capacity of the muscles to use that oxygen. And at all these levels, there are some limitations. And of course, it makes sense. It must end at a certain point. You can't just push it to the infinite. It doesn't exist. I mean, it's like, for example, people that ask the question, can we still run the 100 meters faster? My answer is yes, probably. We probably haven't found the extreme genetic variant, which is even better than Usain Bolt. But it's also clear that we'll come to an asymptote, and then the record will not change anymore, because that's what the human race can do. We'll never run the race in 0 seconds, of course. Same goes for VO2 max. I mean, VO2 max is still higher, higher, higher. We're now approaching the 100 milliliters per kilogram per minute in certain extreme athletes, but it won't increase forever. So there is a ceiling. Now, the whole discussion is now about whether we actually hit the real quote-unquote ceiling when we're doing a VO2 max test. And one group of exercise physiologists says yes, clearly, because if you do this and if you do that and if you do so and if you do this, that's it. I mean, you can't go beyond. Noakes says, I don't believe that, because here are some indications that actually the heart is not pushed to its limit. Here are some indications that actually the legs are not really pushed to its limits, and etc. And then he has been playing around with different paradigms to try to measure VO2 max, because it's very protocol dependent. It's not very easy. And usually today, the typical protocol is an incremental protocol, and then you have certain criteria. It's like a leveling off of the oxygen consumption. It's a heart rate plus or minus 10 beats from your expected maximum heart rate. It's a lactate beyond whatever concentration in your blood. And it's a perceived exertion or difficulty of the effort, which is judged as being very high by the subject. And everything together is then said, well, it's a true VO2 max. Remains pretty subjective in my point of view, but that's what people tend to look at. And Noakes says, well, yeah, no, I'm not convinced by that. I think it's a bit of a fuzzy thing. And my argument is, I think it's the brain that just puts the brake on. And some people are getting closer to the real limit, and other people can't get that close. It's the brain that caps it off some way, and there's some leeway, and maybe you could actually get a bit further to the ceiling, but we don't. So what he did was he devised a new way of trying to get as high VO2 max as you can, and it's called the reverse protocol. And the trick is that instead of doing an incremental protocol where you increase power output more and more and measure what happens with gas exchange and oxygen uptake and consumption by the body, you turn it the way around. You start out very, very high, and then you try to gradually reduce the intensity. Why? Because it becomes possible to maintain the effort, because if you would keep it that high, of course you're exhausted within seconds. But if you reduce it, you can trick the system, the brain, in trying to recruit the muscles necessary to keep up this decreasing effort, and you allow the heart and the muscles and the respiration to reach heights that you would normally not be able to reach if you would do an incremental exercise. So it's an interesting paradigm, and it gives arguments to Noakes, saying, you see, it's not that simple. Apparently, here is another way of trying to organize things, where apparently it might have been the brain that had been limiting the system in the other paradigm.
Thank you very much.